Thank you. Thank you, Karen. Good morning. Welcome to Owego United Methodist Church. To everyone here in the sanctuary and those of us visiting online, there are some opportunities for ministry this week. Today we are having a hymn sing in place of the sermon because Nancy is on vacation. She will be back in the office on Tuesday. I'll explain more about the hymn sing after we're done with announcements. Tomorrow is January 1st. Happy New Year. Tuesday at 10 a.m., the knitting group will be meeting. On Wednesday, January 3rd at 9 a.m., the men's group will be meeting. And from 5 to 6 p.m., there'll be a prayer group in the Wesley House. And next Sunday, January 7th, Sunday school will resume at 9:30 a.m. And 10:30 a.m. is our celebration of worship, including Holy Communion. And from 3 to 5 p.m. next Sunday is an open house at the Parsonage at 276 Main Street. Come for fellowship, hot cider, and finger foods. You don't need to bring anything. Just come when you can, leave when you need to, but please come. And also a reminder that the heat in the Barton Education Building has been turned way down, but you can still use the elevator, go through the glass doors from the parking lot, and use the elevator. Okay, now our hymn sing today, I will be giving a background, a little bit of background on the hymns as we sing them. And during the sermon, you can remain seated, and because we're going to be doing 10 hymns, I think, during the hymn sing, and two or three verses. So, but I will explain, and I wanted to say, O Holy Night is the hymn that Karen played and the prelude. And the story of O Holy Night is as dramatic as when the popular Christmas carol crescendos to the verse that rings out, fall on your knees, O hear the angel voices, O night divine, O night when Christ was born. It has been recorded hundreds of times throughout the world by the likes of Mariah Carey, Celine Dion, Josh Groban, Lauren Daigle, the cast of Glee, Martina McBride, and Tommy Brennan, and the Monarchs, who reached number one on the official Irish singles chart in 1971 with their version. Throughout the world, congregations rejoice in the promise brought by Jesus' divine birth by singing the words with a thrill of hope, a weary world rejoices. Are there any other announcements? Please prepare your hearts and minds to worship our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Please rise as you're able for the call to worship. God has sent his Son into the world for our salvation.
Thanks be to God.
We are called to carry the good news to all the world.
Thanks be to God.
Our first hymn is Hark the Herald Angels Sing. It's hymn number 240. The opening lines of the favorite Christmas hymn echo Luke 2, verse 14. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace. Immediately, the hymn writer established a cosmic connection between the heavenly chorus and our hope for peace on earth. Charles Wesley began that with the prophets, the Annunciation of Mary, the Annunciation to Mary, the journey to Bethlehem, or the search for a room, but in the middle of the action. Rather than citing the final phrase of Luke 2:14, goodwill toward men, he offers his theological interpretation, God and sinners rejoiced.
Thank you.
Please be seated. Please join me in the prayer of confession. Merciful God, we confess that we have not always been obedient. We have not always joined in your message of love or sung glory to the newborn King. Draw us closer to Jesus and to each other. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Please be in an attitude of prayer. Heavenly Father, it's New Year's Eve. On this threshold of a new year, we turn and return again to you. The year spreads before us with possibilities and challenges, joys and concerns. Thank you for all that you've allowed into our lives this past year, the good things and the hard things that have reminded us how much we need you and rely on your presence filling us every day. We thank you for having been with us through the days of this past year. Thank you for your steadfast love and mercies that came every single day this past year, whether we are aware of them or not. You remained faithful to everything that you promised in Jesus. In the closing of 2023, we have seen the images of war-torn countries, terrorist attacks, hunger, poverty, and despair. Your heart grieves when your children anywhere are hurting. Our hearts grieve too. We know that even in the midst of winter, there is hope for spring. And even in the midst of grief, there are signs of hope. Children embraced, lives touched by grace, heroes who surface in times of trial. In the midst of the good and the bad, hear our prayer for this new year. We pray for your spirit to lead us each step of 2024. We ask that you guide our decisions and turn our hearts to deeply desire you above all else. We ask that you open the doors that need to be opened and close the ones that need to be shut tight. We ask that you help us release our grip on the things to which you said no, not yet, or wait. We ask for help to pursue you first above every dream and desire you've put within our hearts. We ask for your wisdom, strength, and power to be constantly present within us. We pray you will make us strong and courageous for the road ahead. Give us ability beyond what we feel we are capable of, and let our gifts flow freely through us so that we would be honored by our lives, so that you would be honored by our lives, and others would be drawn to you. We pray that you will keep us far from the snares and traps of temptations, that you would whisper in our ear when we need to run, and whisper in our heart when we need to stand our ground. As the days of the new year unfold, grant us an ever closer walk with you. Help us to put sin to death and help us gladly yield our lives completely to Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, that we may regard ourselves entirely at his disposal to be, to go, and to do as he would want us to do. May it be our privilege to serve him, to bring glory to him, to help others to know him better, and to help some to come to him for the very first time. We pray that you will go with us into this new year. We pray for your protection over our family and friends. We ask that you hand to cover us and keep us distanced from the enemy's evil intent, that you would be a barrier to surround us and that we'd be safe in your hands. We pray that you will give us discernment and insight beyond our years to understand your will, hear your voice, and know your ways. And now, in the words Jesus taught us to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our
daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
I'd like to bring the children and youth forward, and anyone of any age who'd like to come up. We gotta have you come. We'd miss you way too much. Oh, Jen, could you grab my paper over there, please? Now, you guys heard that Pastor Nancy's on vacation? Well, Mr. Bear went on vacation with Nancy. Yes. So I brought in a Tootsie Roll can, if you guys want to put in your coins, and we'll put those into Mr. Bear next week when he comes back. Thank you. Oh. Jennifer has a couple of things. Did you guys have a nice Christmas? I saw you got a pretty new coat. It's a nice coat. I liked it. I got a coat once when I was your age for Christmas. It was a fur coat that I wore at Easter. Yeah, did anybody get any of these? Do you know what that is? That's a candy cane. And did you know that candy canes have special meaning about Jesus? Did you know that? You did. Okay, and Jenny's going to hold those for me. We're going to talk a little bit about meaning of a candy cane. A candy cane has white stripes. Do you know what white stripes mean? That Jesus washed away all our sins. And Jesus was pure and good. And a candy cane has red stripes. The red stripes are for the blood he shed for us. And an upside down candy cane is a, what letter is that, Molly? It's right there. You have to turn it the other way. Yeah. J. Right. That's a J. What would J stand for? Upside down. It's Jesus. Yeah, that's for Jesus. And the candy cane is hard, right? And hard like a rock. And Jesus is our rock. And a candy cane turned the right way, is a shepherd's staff. And Jesus is our good shepherd. Yeah. And put two candy canes together, and they make a heart. And Jesus loves you. And when you ask Jesus into your heart, you'll be saved too. And a candy cane also has a sweet taste and smell of peppermint. And peppermint reminds us of the gifts that the wise men brought to Jesus. Frankincense and myrrh. What do you think about that? You probably want a candy cane. Yeah, I know. Okay, I do have some for you. Okay, so bow your heads and pray with me. Dear Jesus, we believe that you love us. That you came into the world to save us. And we ask that you forgive us of our sins. We want to know more about you. And we ask that you come into our lives and hearts and teach us how to love you. In your name we pray. Amen. That's the story. Oh, no, your baby sister can't have a candy cane. Want one for mom, too? Okay. Fine with me. I made a lot. You can take as many as you want to, too, Sarah. Take one for Palmer. Sure, you can take two. Thanks for all your help, Jen.
You're welcome.
I'm getting my steps in today. Oh, I think I already did the morning prayer and the Lord's Prayer, didn't I? Yeah, there we go. Okay. All right, so now we're up to the offertory. Will the ushers please come forward for our daily offering? Lord of peace and hope, the gifts we offer to you pale when our minds try to grasp all you have given us in this season. Wholeness in our woundedness, hope in our despair, peace in our turmoil, forgiveness in our rebellion. Like Simeon, we have listened with our ears that we might not miss you, and our eyes have seen your salvation. You gave us light in our darkness, and hope in our discernment. Help us embrace your extravagant generosity as we give ourselves to others. In our Savior's holy name we pray. Amen. Amen. Our next hymn is hymn number 234, O Come All Ye Faithful, and we will be singing verses 1, 2, 3, and 6. Wait. Yes. Almost. We read this first. O Come All Ye Faithful. The song has deeper roots than many realize and can be traced back to its initial Latin publication in 1760, originally named Adeste Fidelis. This version was written by John Francis Wade. Published in 1760, authorities believe that the original date of the song's creation was in 1743. Over subsequent years, the song has evolved, with certain stanzas falling away as new ones are added. In particular, the fourth and fifth stanzas have changed significantly. This is largely due to changes in language and the overall tone and themes of the song. However, it has transcended borders and continues to be one of the most popular hymns and Christmas carols in the entire country.
Thank you.
be seated. This morning's scripture lessons comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 2, verses 22 through 40. When the time came for their purification, according to the law of Moses, they brought him up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every firstborn male shall be designated as holy to the Lord. And they offered a sacrifice according to what is stated in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. This man was righteous and devout, looking forward to the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit rested on him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Messiah. Guided by the Spirit, Simeon came to the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what was customary under the law, Simeon took him into his arms, praised God, saying, Master, now you are dismissing your servant in peace, according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles, and for the glory to your people Israel. And the child's father and mother were amazed at what was being said about him. Then Simeon blessed them and said to the mother Mary, this child is destined for the falling and rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be opposed, so that the inner thoughts of many will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your own soul too. There was also a prophet, Anna, the daughter of Penuel, of the tribe of Asher. She was of great age, having lived with her husband 7 years after her marriage, then as a widow to the age of 84. She never left the temple, but worshiped there with fasting and prayer night and day. At that moment she came and began to praise God and to speak about the child to all who were looking for the redemption of Jerusalem. When they had finished everything required by the law of the Lord, they returned to Galilee, to their own town of Nazareth. The child grew and became strong, filled with wisdom, and the favor of God was upon him. The word of God for the people of God. Now we're going to be doing our hymn sing. Oh boy. Remain seated if you'd like, because we are going to be singing several hymns and several verses. But if you want to stand, that's fine too. The choir will be leading us with Barely at the microphone to help us with our hymns. And I will read a little background on each of the hymns before Karen plays. Our first hymn is O Come, O Come, Emmanuel. That's hymn number 211 in the hymnal. It will be up, all the hymns will be up on the wall, and we will be singing verses 1 and 6. This hymn is ancient in both music and words. While this tune was finalized in the 1800s, it is based on plain song, a type of music used in the church of medieval times. Go ahead, Karen.
Until the Son of God appears, rejoice.
Our next hymn is Star Child. It's hymn number 2095 in the Faith We Sing. And there is a correction. There are only 5 verses. So we will be singing verses 1 and 5. Now, New Zealander Shirley Orina Murray, one of the most accomplished living hymn writers in the English language, brings a poignant text set to a beautiful melody by Carlton Young. A close examination of the words reveals a song rooted in Christian and human reality. This message is through a series of short descriptive modifiers before child. In very economical language, she catalogs children of all ages and stations of life. Street child, beat child, hurt child, used child, grown child, old child, and child, lost child. All of these children are created in the image of the star child, earth child, of stanza 1, and the hope for peace child of stanza 5. The refrain, "This year let the day arrive," is a petition for the presence of the Christ child for everyone alive. Our next hymn is Silent Night, hymn number 239, and we will be singing verses 1, 3, and 4. Silent Night was written in 1818 by Joseph Moore and Francis X. Gruber. Silent Night was first heard by Austrian villagers attending Christmas Eve Mass in St. Nicholas Church in Oberndorf. Please excuse my pronunciation. This was not my forte in school. It was Christmas Eve, 1818, when the now famous carol was first performed as Stille Nacte, Heilige Nacte. Joseph Moore, the young priest who wrote the lyrics, played the guitar and sang along with Francis Xavier Gruber, the choir director, who had written the melody. The composition evolved and was translated into over 300 languages with many different arrangements from various voices and ensembles. It was sung in churches and town squares, even in the battlefield during World War I, when during a temporary truce on Christmas Eve, soldiers sang carols from home. Silent Night, by 1914, known around the world, was sung simultaneously in French, German, and English.
Oh,
Our next hymn is hymn number 227, The Friendly Beasts. We will be singing verses 1, 2, and 6. The Friendly Beasts probably originated in the 12th century France. This song is distinctive in that each of the animals sings to the newborn Christ child in the first person, offering a gift to comfort him. Stanza 1 sends the scene of a stable rood with a baby surrounded by friendly beasts. Each of the next four stanzas is taken by one of the friendly beasts who offers Jesus a gift. The donkey offers transportation to Bethlehem for Jesus' mother. The cow gives its manger, or feeding trough, as a place to rest. The sheep provides wool for a warm coat on Christmas. The dove and its mate coo the baby Jesus to sleep. The final stanza summarizes that all the beasts, by some good spell, were pleased to offer a gift to Emmanuel. Robert Davis is attributed with the writing of the English words we now sing, probably in the 1920s, though they were first published in 1934. Many artists have recorded the song, including Peter, Paul, and Mary, Burl Ives, Harry Belafonte, Johnny Cash, and Garth Brooks. Our next hymn is hymn number 238, Angels We Have Heard on High, verses 1 and 3. In Luke 2:14, we find the canticle of the angel's song, one of the most famous and frequently sung of the Christmas canticles. The refrain of Angels We Have Heard on High is taken directly from this verse. The entire hymn is a traditional French carol that originated as early as the 18th century and was published in North America for the Diocese of Quebec in 1819. Angels We Have Heard on High is a song of invitation from Christmas to others to come to celebrate Christ's birth with them. The carol begins in a festive spirit, but then in the second stanza asks, why is there a celebration? In the third stanza, an invitation is given to join the celebration. The fourth stanza concludes with the carol with the observation of Christ's birth and the Christian's joyful response. Our next hymn is hymn number 249. There's a song in the air. We will be singing verses 1 and 2. The writer of this hymn, Josiah Gilbert Holland, was himself born in a poor, struggling family in Massachusetts. After working in a factory to help the family finances, he went to school, studying at Berkshire Medical College, where he graduated in 1844. There is something captivating about this simple Christmas hymn with its almost childlike wonder. The first stanza is a series of declarative statements that invite the singer to marvel at Christ's birth as if we were physically present at the event. Next hymn is hymn number 246, Joy to the World. We will be singing verses 1 and 2. Joy to the World is perhaps an unlikely popular Christmas hymn. First of all, it is based on a psalm, and second, it celebrates Christ's second coming much more than the first. This favorite Christmas hymn is the result of a collaboration of at least three people, and it draws its initial inspiration not from the Christmas narrative in Luke 2, or from Psalm 98.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come.
Our next hymn is hymn number 218, It Came Upon a Midnight Clear. We will be singing verses 1 and 3. This may be the only commonly sung Christmas carol in our hymnals that does not mention the birth of Christ. The focus is rather on the song of the angels, peace on earth, goodwill to men, taken from Luke 2, verse 14. As United Methodist hymnal editor Carlton Young puts it so well, the hymn's central theme contrasts the scourge of war with the song of the angels, peace to God's people on earth. He observes that this is one of the earliest social gospel hymns written in the United States. The current stanza 3 in the United Methodist hymnal poignantly articulates the situation of so many, with images of those beneath life's crushing load, whose forms are bending low, who toil among the climbing way with painful steps and slow. The second half of this stanza offers hope for the song of the blessed angels who bend on hovering wings would soothe the battle sounds of a suffering world. Our next hymn is hymn number 245, The First Noel. We will be singing verses 1 and 5. What does Noel mean? Noel, the English transliteration, comes from the Old French Noël, or Noel, modern French. The derivation from this word probably relates to the earlier Latin term natalis, or birth. In Latin, dies natalis means birthday. Some suggest that Noel is also related to novellare or novel, meaning new, I guess, something to tell. Originally in 9 stanzas, 5 are commonly used in most hymnals today. Though the angel's appearance to the shepherds in Luke 2, verses 1 through 20, is the subject of the first stanza, most of the carol focuses on the journey of the Magi, Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 through 12, giving the carol an epiphany focus. Our final hymn in the hymn sing, you'll be singing one more hymn, and the hymn sing is We Three Kings, hymn number 254. We will be singing verses 1 and 5. The author and composer, John Henry Hopkins, Jr., was born in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. He became recognized as a leading Episcopal church musician. Following his ordination in 1872, Hopkins served as a rector of two parishes, Trinity Church in Plattsburgh, New York, and Christ Church in Williamsport, Pennsylvania. Hopkins wrote the carol around 1857, based on the narrative of the journey of the Magi in Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. We don't know how many Magi there were, but this hymn suggests there were three because of the three gifts. Stanzas 2, 3, and 4 describe in detail the symbolic nature of each of these three gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. The imagery of the star is central to the Epiphany season and the narrative. The refrain focuses on the star and invites us to join the Magi at following its light. Guide us to thy perfect light.
Thank you.
Please rise as you're able for our final hymn. It will be hymn number 254, Go Tell It on the Mountain. I have 254 on here. 251, thank you. 251. My brain's not working. It's all this reading. Go Tell It on the Mountain. John Work was a professor of Latin and Greek, but spent much of his time roaming the Appalachian Mountains with his brother Frederick. Go Tell It on the Mountain was first published in 1907, when John Work added to the stanzas the chorus that had long been sung throughout Appalachia. God who gave us this year, the Savior who walked by our side each day, and the Spirit who filled us with abundant life, grace the coming year with peace and joy and hope. Amen.
I'm sorry.